Just to keep everyone informed, we did receive word a few minutes ago that the hearse has had a puncture. We were hoping that they would still be here by 12:30, but they're not. So that's why we're all still waiting. And the orders of service will arrive then as well. So. take about another 10 minutes, hopefully. Thank you. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. We meet here this afternoon to say our farewells to Gerald, Jerry Parsons, friends, work colleagues, fellow Salvationists, family. All of us are here with our memories of Jerry, his energy, enthusiasm, his no-nonsense approach to life, and his desire to display Christ. We miss him already. We give thanks for a life well lived, and we thank God for the impression Jerry made on those who knew him. So let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for the life of Jerry and the years that his family and friends, all of us, have been able to share with him. We pray that your arms of love will especially surround Hilda, Stephen, Andrew, and Kath. And we thank you that at this time of sorrow, you promise to comfort us. We recognize that you also experienced bereavement whilst living as a man. You also suffered death on a cross. And so we come to you as one who understands. Be near to us in the days and months that lie ahead. Amen. Jerry gave very clear, typed out instructions for his funeral. The music played by the band, the songs we sing, all of it has been selected by Jerry. The band played for us as we came in the march Rose Hill. In Jerry's notes, I find this: Rose Hill was a large country house near Reading used by a department of the Salvation Army during the Second World War. Jerry's parents worked for that department, and so an affection for that march was established. Here is our first song we'll sing together. One I can say that I don't think I've ever sung in a funeral before, but why not? What a testimony. Who is it tells me what to do and helps me to obey? Here is Jerry giving us the Salvation Army salute. That's the spirit. Holy Spirit. But there's another reason too for this song. Jerry writes that he was the treasurer of the Salvation Army Police Officers Fellowship for many years, and that this was used as their anthem. He was also, of course, the Corps Secretary for nearly 44 years. So let's sing together this song just now and celebrate the life of Jerry. Thank you. And now we're going to listen as Stephen brings to us his tribute on behalf of the family.
Well, firstly, I'd like to thank all of you for attending, you know, and being here with the family today. It's really great to see, you know, a moving occasion, and nice to see so many people have actually sort of joined with us today, so thank you very much. While funerals are often sad and emotional occasions, as you can see, Dad wanted a rousing funeral, and to be carried in and out of this hall by his boys while his favourite marches were being played. And I thank Carl, the bandmaster, Cardiff Canton Band, and all the guest players for doing your part in honouring Dad's wish. So rather than mourn his loss, let's celebrate his long life and be proud to have been connected through family or friendship to such a larger-than-life personality. Born into a Salvation Army family in Rochdale in 1930, the years before and through the Second World War had their fair share of hardships, as Dad would often tell us. Money was always scarce, and Dad and his sisters Enid and Audrey were raised knowing what frugality meant. As you can imagine, that early experience of hardship shaped Dad's character, his incredible resilience and objection to anything being discarded. While too young to serve during World War II, he left the hardships of civilian life in 1947 to undertake his 5 years of national service as a military policeman in the Royal Air Force, spending much of his service overseas in the Far East. Whenever we mentioned Singapore or Malaysia in conversation, you know, Dad would immediately start reminiscing about his military life while stationed in those countries as if it was only yesterday. Dad left the Royal Air Force in 1952 and a year later joined Cardiff City Police. He met my dear mum Hilda through the Salvation Army, and they were married in April 1954 and been together for 68 years. For 30 years, Dad policed the streets of Cardiff, doing his best to keep the local communities safe from harm. The petty criminals and troublemakers in Cardiff all knew of Sergeant Jerry Parsons. We sometimes witnessed his style of policing. As a child, I remember Dad announcing that the family were going on a train journey to Portsmouth. Excitedly, we set off on arrival, Mum took Catherine, Andrew and I to visit our aunts, cousins and grandparents, leaving Dad at the train station. Returning to the station a few hours later, we met Dad again, who was now handcuffed to another man. It turned out that Dad had been sent to Portsmouth by the police to bring a criminal back to Cardiff and thought we could use the opportunity to visit his relatives. We rode home on the train, sitting next to a guy on the Cardiff Police Most Wanted list. If Dad was on duty at Cardiff City football matches, my brother Andrew and I would sometimes go to Ninian Park to watch the game. Entering the police hut in the stadium one Saturday, I asked Dad why there were so many pairs of Dr. Martin's boots stacked high in a corner of one of the rooms. "Stephen, if the local football hooligans want to watch the match, they must take off their boots and leave them here and watch the game standing in their socks to prevent them from kicking people, especially me and my police unit." How those football fans retrieved their own boots after the game was not his concern. He was a policeman from a bygone era. And my childhood was never dull, and family holidays with Dad were memorable events, especially the camping trips. On a few occasions, we arrived at the campsite in daylight, but we're still erecting our tent in the dark, with Dad angrily trying to figure out why the tent poles were all mixed up. During a holiday in Belgium, Dad hired a multi-seat pedal bike for the family to ride. We set off cycling along a path, with Dad steering and the rest of us providing the pedal power. After a few minutes, we left the path and were soon cycling through what appeared to be a nicely manicured and tree-lined park. However, after noticing that people were shouting and waving their arms at us, we soon realized that Dad had taken a wrong turn, and we were now cycling over the fairways of a public golf course. And alarmingly, our pedal bike had left two prominent tire tracks on the large green we had just crossed. We cycled away as fast as we could, as you can imagine. Retiring from the police in the early 80s, Dad continued to represent the interests of retired police officers as a long-serving committee member of the Cardiff branch of the National Association of Retired Police Officers. And the NAPO flag is proudly laid upon his coffin. Unfortunately, in his early 70s, Dad's health started to suffer, which affected his enjoyment of life. He told me the doctors gave him 5 years, but he lived for another 22. He was more resilient than the boots he wore when pounding the beat. Dad could be impatient, loud, pedantic, and persistent, but was also caring, loving, generous, and always overly protective of his family. He took great delight watching his children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren grow and develop. Dad's sense of humor was vibrant, more colorful than a rainbow, and often politically incorrect. But we laughed, raised our eyebrows, and learned to live with his jokes. And our dad was meticulous in having everything in its place. And if any of his possessions went missing or were borrowed and not returned, it became a major incident. On one occasion, after a tiring 20-hour journey back to Hong Kong from Wales, I called Dad as I arrived home. His first words were, "Stephen, have you borrowed my screwdriver? It's not in the garage." I said, "Dad, it's not with me, but I'll check my suitcase just to be sure." It wasn't wise to be in the family home whenever his TV remote control was mislaid. We were all guilty of having lost it until it was found quite often down the inside of his favorite armchair. I think it's true to say that Dad was the original Victor Meldrew. And while Dad had many admirable qualities, on occasions, he could test the patience of a saint. Standing tall and proud in his army uniform, which he's wearing today, Dad served the Salvation Army with distinction, especially here in Cardiff Canton Corps. For almost 50 years, he played in the band and always enjoyed marching through the streets of Canton on Sundays playing his E-flat bass. He often placed the Salvation Army ahead of family matters and his police career. Like many people, Dad never wanted to spend his last years in a nursing home and didn't adjust very well to life in care, but through exemplary support from Andrew, Catherine, Mum, and other family members, close friends, and the staff at College Fields Nursing Home in Barry, his life was made as comfortable as possible. Knowing Dad, that wasn't an easy task. I was able to spend time with Dad during my visit home in July, and while rapidly declining, he still found the energy to laugh as we recalled some of our earlier times together, especially those camping trips. Such was his foresight and character, it should be no surprise that Dad planned his funeral in his 60s. Many years ago, he asked me, "Stephen, will you fly home for my funeral?" I said, "Of course, Dad, when is it?" "Well, Stephen, not for at least another 20 years. I said, "Oh, Dad, that's great news. I have more time to buy a black suit." He did enjoy the humor, you know, if you know Father very well. And, "Oh, and Stephen, by the way, give me a good send-off." Well, I think everyone here is helping us to do just that. And of course, with Dad being a loyal supporter of the monarchy, it is fitting that his funeral is taking place shortly after the funeral of Queen Elizabeth II. He would have enjoyed knowing that himself. So, Dad, as your soul is now on its way to those pearly gates of heaven, I do hope the angels are fully prepared for who they are about to receive, as I'm sure you'll be keeping them busy for a long time to come. And let's hope they don't lose your heavenly TV remote control. So, Dad, I bid you farewell. May you rest in peace, and hopefully we'll get to meet again in the afterlife. Your loving son, Stephen.
Thank you, Stephen. And now we sing again another of Jerry's choices. "I'm Climbing Up the Golden Stairs to Glory." So let us stand and sing together, please.
Thank you.
Let's take our seats. Kath is going to read for us some scripture. First, Jerry's request, his favourite verse from Isaiah chapter 54, verse 10, and then some verses I've selected from Paul's letter to the Romans.
Though the mountains be shaken and the hills be removed, yet my unfailing love for you will not be shaken, nor my covenant of peace be removed, says the Lord who has compassion on you. What then shall we say in response to this? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for all us, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
Now let's listen as the band plays Jerry's chosen hymn tune arrangement, Colne. Though the mountains be shaken and the hills be removed, yet my unfailing love for you will not be shaken, nor my covenant of peace be removed, says the Lord who has compassion on you. That's the verse of scripture Jerry wanted us to hear today at his funeral. Though the mountains be shaken. As a policeman, his working life brought him up close to the devastation wrought by the shaking of many metaphorical mountains. But Jerry understood the unfailing love of God and recognized its power to make a difference. Unfailing. This favorite verse of his recognizes in God a rock-solid constancy, a dependability. My unfailing love for you will not be shaken, nor my covenant of peace removed. And it seems to me that somehow Jerry sought to model that aspect of God in his own life. At band practice last evening, our Corps Sergeant Major Chris Heaven spoke movingly about Jerry's reliability. You always knew where you stood with Jerry Parsons. You could count on him. And as Chris spoke, I sensed a collective nod from all who listened. Yes, that was Jerry, constant, dependable. Was it just the way he was wired? Only the makeup of his personality? Perhaps. Or could it be that he had so recognized the dependability and constancy of God, that unfailingness mentioned in this verse from Isaiah? He had so recognized these in the character of God that he had decided to make them his own. I think that partly explains Jerry Parsons, the man. And I think that Jerry would say to us this afternoon that this is the best way to live. Take what we learn about God from Scripture and decide to make it somehow our own. If that is what God is like, then I want some of that too. It doesn't happen by mere striving, though striving is good. God's love demonstrated in our lives is a fruit of our relationship with him. It's something that grows as a consequence of us opening ourselves up to him. When we do that, we start to plant, by our living, little islands of heaven on earth. And then one day, like Jerry is now doing, we will experience heaven in all its completeness. But while we are alive in this world, we too can have some of that dependable, unshakability, which is characteristic of God and which was somehow mirrored in Jerry's life. I've said before that sometimes there is a temptation to let the things we read in the Bible stay as only words, nice thoughts, something to console, merely an anesthetic for our troubled minds. But God's love and dependability is always much more than words. He demonstrated it in real rescue, centuries before Isaiah spoke that favorite verse of Jerry's, when the people of Israel were delivered from Egyptian slavery. He demonstrated it in the real body, the flesh and blood body of Jesus, walking, talking, teaching, healing, dying for us. And I think Jerry said, I want some of that. I want to model that in my life. And I think he did. And so can you. And so can I. God's love is more than just words. And we give thanks too, because heaven is not merely a nice idea. Heaven, the reign of God and the concrete love of God, is not far off in the future or far away. Heaven is also down here. And happening in every act of human kindness. In all of these, heaven happens some more. In our loving, giving, caring, supporting, healing. God turns the hope of heaven into something which is solid and substantial, and God dwells yet more fully with his people. Heaven comes down, and glory fills my soul. The heaven which begins for us in this life, we see only as if peering through a dark glass, the Apostle Paul writes. The clutter of the world and the wickedness of the human heart mean that our experience of it is partial. But Scripture paints a picture of a new heaven which is so solid and so enduring that death is no disqualification. When our bodies have failed us, when everything has passed away, heaven will still endure. And one day, we, like Jerry and all those who have gone before us, striving to embrace heaven in this life, one day we will enjoy heaven in all its fullness, because God makes all things new. This afternoon we have grief in our hearts. It is right that we should grieve as we mourn the loss of Jerry. But what shall we say in response to this? Kath read for us earlier, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword?" No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Let us stand as we sing together the final hymn here before I pronounce the benediction. In a moment, we'll be making our way to Barry Crematorium, and then following that, you are welcome to join the family at the clubhouse at St Andrew's, Colebrook Road East, Caddoxton, Barry. Let us share a blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.